in time for the start of this webinar. I would like to introduce myself. I'm Manuel Sergi. I'm associate professor of analytical chemistry at University of Teramo. It's a town in the center of Italy, not so far from Rome. Our faculty is the Faculty of Bioscience and Technologies for Food, Agriculture and Environment. So we have a multidisciplinary faculty in which very, very different skills and knowledge and approach are present. And so this is also nice for us to work here, to have also good exchanges also with people with different culture, no? And my area of interest are mainly food safety, but also food quality, and recently also forensic toxicology, no, in particular the toxicology of illicit drugs and new psychoactive substances. No, but now we will talk about food safety first of all. That it was the main activity. So it was at the beginning the main activity. Now I'm working on really different fields, but all the fields that join all my interest is the use of a specific technique that is liquid chromatography and mass spectrometry. Now, and this is the focus of this webinar of today. This opportunity to share some information and some ideas with you. I don't know which is the audience, no? Which is if I'm talking with analytical. So I am an analytical chemist, and so I usually use an approach and a language, the language of analytical chemistry. This is my language, but I will try to make this presentation, I hope, interesting also for people that have not so deep knowledge in analytical chemistry, you know. And so I will do also a small introduction of this technique. Now, many of you maybe already knows what I will say, but as ancient Romans said, no, repetita iuvant. So if you repeat something, it's never wrong. So this is because I really don't have information about the audience, and so we can also be flexible. Now, if I talking about things that everybody knows, you can say okay, skip, and we will follow, because we have quite a large number of slides and things to say, and so I will try to make a fast overview on these arguments. And first of all, a little introduction about for food safety is important to make a little introduction in the regulation in the legal framework in which we are moving, especially particularly in the European Union. There is a very strict system of rules for about food safety that have been introduced. I'm citing in the slide the regulation 2377 that is from since 1990. It is important because it was the first time in which different countries decided to share the same rules. No, and before this this step, each country of now European Union now has the same rules, and this is natural for especially for young people now that were born in this situation. But before this, each country has its own rules, especially different. Each country had different maximum residue limit for each molecule, for each pesticide, for each herbicide, for each in different. We were talking about pesticide and so, but this is true for both pesticide, mycotoxin, or antibiotics, or even environmental contaminants. No, and this was the first time in which different countries decided to have the same rules, and this was useful for the movements of the food stuff that was produced in each country, and so this situation enabled the free movement of the different foodstuff produced in the different countries. And then, of course, I will not make the history of this of all the legal framework, but just the first and another important is the 657 02 that put another important step in this framework, because established that not only the same maximum residue limit were necessary to guarantee the same quality, level of quality and safety, but it was important also to have the same level of quality in the analytical approach. And so was established the validation protocols that were applied for the control institution to use to apply for the food safety controls in the foodstuff in for the coming in and the and also for the export of the food stuff. And so it was another important step. Then of course the legal framework is very rich, and there is maybe someone can say too many regulation and too many, but the thing that really in all the countries of the UE territory there are the same rules, the same regulations, the same a level of attention, and this is very important because on one end guarantee the free movement of the foodstuff, on the other end guarantee a high level of safety regarding the food, no? And this is very important. And then there are the last I think the last, I don't know if in the last days something new has happened, but it is the Sante 11813 of 2017 that established also the level, the protocols, the procedures for the sampling, extraction, analysis, validation of the analytical protocols. Then there is the MRL, as we said, that are common for all the European Union, that are established for each molecule related with each kind of foodstuff, no? And this is the website that you can very easily find all the maximum residue limit for each kind of foodstuff or for each kind of pesticide in the different matrices, and so an important aspect of the of this regulation is a two level of control that involve a screening level, a first level of analysis, and a second level of analysis. So a screening, a first screening that and then a confirmation level. So I now, if a positivity occurs at the screening level, now a green light appear if a positivity in the second level in the confirmation step, in this case a red light will appear. But and so this is the step, no? There is the test with the screening method. Then if a positivity is found, then and this sample is called suspect positive, and then it is submitted to a further level of control, now by means of a confirmatory method that then will have a legal significance. And so in this case, now an alert will appear, and then some procedures will be applied by the control entities. And these two level of control are associated with different kind of analytical approach. So for the screening method, you have the aim of this kind of analysis are designed to have a high sample throughput, no? Because this is important to analyze a large number of samples in a small time. So in this way it's possible really to have a significant number of sample to be analyzed. Of course, higher is the number of analyzed sample, higher will be the level of confidence for safety purposes. And these methods are specifically designed to avoid false compliant results. So the false compliant is when a sample now is declared compliant, so no traces of contaminants or below the maximum residue limits. So in this case, when a sample is declared compliant in the first level, no more control are made on this sample, and it has a green light to enter into the market. Then there is a randomized control in the last step in the market, in the shops, no, but in this case these foodstuff will start to be diffused in the marketplaces, etc. So it is very, very important to have a very small average, a very small percentage of false compliant results. And so there is a strict validation in for also for the screening methods, because it is very important to minimize this error. This is called a beta error, that it's for the validation of a screening method, it has to be below 5% of beta error. No, and this is to be it has to be demonstrated and traced and validated to be applied in this case. So as we told before, in case of suspect non-compliant results, these results should be confirmed by a confirmatory method. So while the screening methods are usually involving for example, ELISA technique or immunochemical techniques in general, so very fast method, fast and cheap method. For the confirmatory methods, there is the need for an ambiguous identification of the single analyte, the single molecule. The screening methods can also recognize the positivity for a class of compound. No, for example, maybe it is suspect positive for carbamates pesticide. No, in this case, the confirmatory method has to identify the molecule even at the level of isomer or stereo isomers, and so it is very important to identify the molecule. And this case also, so the qualitative identification and the quantitative measuring of the analyte. So we have to provide an ambiguous identification and accurate and reproducibility and reproducible quantification. And so in this case, a very strict validation protocol has to be applied. And so to obtain the analyte identification and the reliable quantification, we need to join two techniques, so chromatographic technique and mass spectrometric technique, because we have to identify the structure of the molecule, and so we need both the separation level, but even but also and the possibility to identify the molecule. And in this case, the coupling of chromatographic and the mass spectrometric techniques are needed for the for this purpose. And of course, we can use both GCMS or LCMS. This is of course depending of the characteristics of the analyte. For example, the polarity. In this case, now we have in this figure we can see, for example, the nonpolar compounds are preferably analyzed by GCMS, while more polar or ionic compounds are analyzed by LCMS. And also, as you know, the GC usually involve high temperature, so also the probe we can have problems for with the thermolabile compounds with the GC analysis. And so in this case, when you have thermolabile compounds, it's preferred to analyze them by means of liquid chromatography, not by means of LCMS. So I think that chromatography is a well-known technique, but so we have a stationary phase and a mobile phase that drive the analytes into the column, producing the separation of the different analytes depending of the affinity toward the mobile phase and the stationary phase, producing a chromatogram. Now, and this is both for GC and for LC. Now, this is the scheme for a GCMS instrument, in which we have the GC called the inlet sample inlet, no, in which we can perform the injection of the sample, and then the GC column in which the chromatographic separation occurs. Then we have it is transported into the mass spectrometer through the can you see the pointer? I have the pointer in the ion source. Do you see it? Okay.
Yes, we see.
And then we have the ionization of the molecules, and then the ion are driven into the mass analyzer for the analyte identification and the quantification by means of the the suitable detector. And then this is the scheme of an HPLC, now a liquid chromatography, a liquid chromatographic system, now in which we have the pump, the injection, the column that could be also put into an oven to keep temperature stable, as temperature, you know, it's very important for the also the stability. In this case, the importance of the thermostatation, of the control of temperature, is the stability of the chromatographic peaks. And then, of course, we need a detector, because chromatography is also a separation technique, so we need a detector to allow the analyte identification and quantification. Then we have two kinds of liquid chromatography. Now we have the adsorption chromatography that is also called normal phase, or the partition chromatography that is called reversed phase. In this case, the silica surface is functionalized with apolar groups, usually alkylic group that allow the retention of the both polar and apolar compounds. And recently also liquid chromatography had very, very important novelty in terms of efficiency, because GC was until the last year more and more efficient in than liquid chromatography. So with the peak capacity, the possibility to analyze a large number of compounds, and because of the very thin chromatographic peaks, instead the liquid chromatography it has a limit by this point of view. And so the introducing of two micron particle, or the introduction of fused core particles, has allowed to obtain an efficiency, you know, the peak shape very similar to gas chromatography without the drawbacks of the gas chromatography. And so in the last years, the coupling of liquid chromatography and mass spectrometry has gained a huge importance in all the field, especially in the field of food analysis, that in which really the improved performances in terms of peak capacity, but especially in terms of sensitivity, you know, the possibility to reach very low limit of quantification has allowed to improve the level of quality, you know, because the possibility to analyze very, very low concentration of the contaminants has allowed to lower also the maximum residue limit, no? Because the MRL has to be realistic, no? Because it is a nonsense to set a very low maximum residue limit if you have not an analytical technique that is able to reach that level of sensitivity. So in this case, it is very important to have a higher performance in the analytical techniques, because it is directly linked to a higher level of food safety. This is a very important aspect in the research for the improvement of the analytical performance, because it is not a pure research, but it gives the possibility to reach direct results in terms of food quality, and so consequently of health for the common people, for the user, for the people who need to eat something healthy now. So in this case, this is, for example, the improvement of the chromatographic performance, in which the UHPLC, no, the ultra high performance liquid chromatography, that allowed to improve the performances in terms of peak quality, and also in terms of sensitivity, because a sharper peak it is also an higher peak, and so the signal is increased as the width, the peak width is smaller. No, this is like a triangle. No, and so it is very very simple also to understand. And so usually the detector for liquid chromatography were the UV detector of the diode array detector, the DID, and so the especially DID is very effective detector for liquid chromatography, but it does not provide the information about the structure of the analytes as it is requested for by the regulations, no? And so the use of mass spectrometry as coupled with chromatography, both LC and GC, allow to measure the particularly the mass to charge ratio in ions. Mass to charge is usually the mass. Now, is mass charge is especially when, and this is in 99% of the cases, the charge is one, and so the mass charge is directly the mass, and so we have directly information, and so the MS have been described as the smallest scale in the world because it can measure the smaller size, so the molecules, so it's a smaller thing, it can be measured. And the ion are generated by loss or gain of a charge of a neutral spaces, and so, and then the ions are driven into the mass spectrometer to produce a spectra like this, you know, in which we have also information by means also the fragmentation of the molecular ion, no, and then we have a different fragment peak that may provide very useful information on the structure of the molecule to be analyzed. So the first MS instruments, they were very complicated to manage. For example, the magnetic sector mass spectrometer, it was a very large instruments, very complicated to manage. They needed a lot of effort to have a reliable analysis, and very difficult to apply. And the introduction, the use of the quadrupole mass analyzer is allowed to the introduction of benchtop instruments. So the very usually a quadrupole is like this. No, it's very very small. It's included in an instrument that can be it allowed the use of benchtop instruments, and so also very very easy to manage and to perform the analysis, and so the introduction of quadrupole has allowed the development of mass spectrometer, also in combination with chromatographic techniques, starting with the GC-MS. It was the interfacing between GC and MS. It was simpler. It was more than 50 years old, this coupling. And then more recent is the coupling of LC and MS, in which the commercial use of LC-MS, it's 20-25 years ago, thanks to the use of the atmospheric pressure ionization interfaces that allowed the coupling of a liquid chromatographic system with a mass spectrometer. And also they allowed the possibility to obtain also the intact molecular ion, because these are mild ionization, soft. This is called the soft ionization techniques, and this means that there is not a fragmentation of the molecular ion. This is good for on one end, and this is a drawback on the other end. But the introduction of the MS-MS, so the tandem MS, so the possibility to have the two MS analyzers in series with a collision cell between them, allowed to perform a double step MS analysis, in which we can have the selection of the molecular ion, the fragmentation of the molecular ion, and to collect also the fragments of deriving only from the precursor of the molecular ion, because we can select by means of the mass spectrometer the a specific ion to be fragmented, and then we can collect the fragmentation spectrum of the specific ion we have selected on the first quadrupole. And this configuration can work in different way now, because a quadrupole can act in scan and in selection scan. So we can have the full scan spectrum, and selection you choose one ion to be analyzed. And so this can be if you check the different acquisition mode, selection and selected ion, or in a full scan in the different quadrupole, a second quadrupole act a collision cell. No, it works or in transmission or in collision. In MS-MS, of course, you need to activate the collision to obtain the fragmentation. But the acquisition mode selected for the quantitative analysis, because in this case you can have different qualitative information about the fragmentation spectra, etc. But for the quantitative analysis, you have to set the tandem MS in selected reaction monitoring. So in selection in the first quadrupole, fragmentation on the second, and in selection in the third quadrupole. So this is the acquisition mode for quantitative analysis. In this case, the MS-MS works as a detector, just as a detector, but with a very high sensitivity and very high selectivity. And these are very very important features for a detector. So I'm calling this system a detector, but it's with special features. This case, this is the example. I don't remember which molecule is this, that is selected the molecular ion, the fragmentation of, we selected three different fragments of these from this ion, and then we can monitor one, two, or even three fragments for each molecule, for each ion selected, so for each analyte. And this is very important because it allows to have an ambiguous identification of the analyte, and also a very high level of sensitivity, because in this case the sensitivity of this kind of analytical system is at level of PPT with a normal system, so not very very high level system, and so this allow really a good level of analysis. And now I would like to show a method. For example, we have developed in our lab involving this is 45 minutes or 1 hour, this seminar? I don't remember, because if I have 5 minutes.
As it has been mentioned, 1 hour it should be.
1 hour, okay, so I have time. Okay, thank you, thanks a lot. So I will show this application. In this case, we have analyzed in a single analytical method different analytes, different pesticides from different classes: organophosphate, carbamides, neonicotinoids, azoline derivatives. So with very 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 different characteristics from each other, and so it was very difficult a few years ago. But now with the LC-MS, you can check the molecular structure of the different analytes, including very polar compounds and also less polar compounds. And with different characteristics coming from different classes, also with the, for example, organophosphates that act as acetylcholine esterase inhibitors. Now it is showed the biological mechanism of these analytes. For example, these are the molecules now included in this group, or the carbamates. In this case, very similar the mechanism, but in this case it is a competitor in postsynaptic receptor, and they causing the signal transmission. But they are also very very effective. In this case, we have selected the carbaryl, maybe is the more common of analyte in these classes, or for example the new nicotinoids like acetamiprid or thiamethoxam that has a different mechanism of action. And I think the last one, okay, zolinic derivative like the thiabenzazole, these are the fungicide that act on the inhibition of the methylase enzyme in this case. So, but let's go to the analytical procedure. In this case, we have seen also, we are talking a lot about the analytical technique, the instrumental analysis, LC-MS, but we have to highlight that often the sample preparation is the critical step. The critical time-consuming step, because of course sampling is essential to have a reliable analysis, but sample preparation usually is the time-consuming step. And it's very, very, very critical one. And nowadays, maybe the most common extraction technique, no, sample preparation technique, is the quashers, you know, quick, effective, cheap, rugged, and safe. This is the acronym of this technique that is dispersive micro solid phase extraction applied to different classes of compounds. No, it's very, very fast and simple to apply, and I think it's at the moment the most common technique that is used in food safety, especially for pesticide analysis. And but I want to show also a different approach based on microextraction on packet sorbent. That is like a solid phase extraction, but in this case with a miniaturized device. In this case, we have reported the different steps of the extraction. We have the classical extraction of the analytes with a suitable extraction system, and then the use of these MAPS device that allow the to minimize also the amount of sample, and it is quite suitable for then the LC MS analysis, because very, very small amount of analyze of sample is needed, and it's very good for a high sensitivity system that allow the detection even at low PPT level. And so the extraction of the analytes is made by a suitable solvent system, checking temperature, centrifugation, filtration, stability. All these steps, of course, should be carefully optimized, and the system had to be set up in the best. So the SPE extraction, so the solid phase extraction, usually at this step, the conditioning of the sorbent phase that is usually inside the cartridge, the loading of the sample containing both the analyte and interferent compounds, the cleaning step, the washing step aimed at the removing of the interfering compounds, and then dilution of the analytes, hoping it could be as selective as possible. In this case, we have used a miniaturized solid phase extraction aimed now to the volume reduction, the reduction of organic solvent, the reduction of sample volume, and also allowing a automation of the system that allow also to minimize the errors, the human errors. And so this is the different step in which the sorbent bed is in the needle of a syringe, so we can perform the different step very, very quickly. Also the system can be, you know, automated, and so each sample it's very, very, very fast in this procedure. And so but the extraction procedure then to be suitable for the next step, that is the LC MS analysis. So all the steps of an analytical procedure is to be linked each other to obtain the best results. So there is not the best extraction procedure or the best analytical method, but it depends, of course, from the analytes, from the metrics, from the possible interfering compounds, also from the level of concentration of the analytes, the maximum residual limit, so the target concentration of this specific problem, no? Because each analyte has a different MRL, depending also by the foodstuff, the matrix we are dealing with, no? And so the very important is also the liquid chromatographic step, because a suitable separation is very important to obtain the final results, because LC-MS are quite linked, and so the chromatographic separation is important. So we have the mass spectrometer, so the separation is not so important, because we have the mass spectrum that allow the identification, but we need to have anyway a good separation, and it is important to have a good separation, and the peak shape as we were talking about before. And so, for example, the use of a core shell particles or smaller particles, we have the same results towards classical columns. You can see the different in peak shape, and so in efficiency and in the analytical performances. In this case, we used a curved gradient for the separation of the analytes, because some of them were not so agree to be separated. They wanted to work together, and so it was very 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 difficult. In some cases there are isomers, and so it was not so simple. And this is the table reporting the MS, the retention time of each compound, and the MS parameters, including the Q1, so the molecular ion mass, the fragment mass. We have selected two fragment ions for each analytes, and then all the parameters for transmission and fragmentation of each analyte. The fragmentation are tailored not only for the analyte, but for the single fragment, in order to obtain the maximum signal for each MRM transition. And this is the result of the analytical procedure, in which you can see the separation of the peak and also the very thick peaks, chromatographic peaks, and it is helped also both the separation, so the peak shape is very important both for separation purpose but also for quantification purpose, because the peak shape in this case helped for the increase of sensitivity. Now, as you can see, that in 5 minutes and 41 we can have the separation of all the analyte. The system is very effective and also very fast. So we have a chromatographic run in 5 minutes plus 3 minutes for the reconditioning of the system. So we can have also in this case a high throughput analysis. Then the problem is important also to use a proper approach for the first of all the qualitative purpose. So the identification of Daniel Light. We need, we were talking at the beginning of this webinar, this speech, the important is the an ambiguous identification, and then here we can have the different parameters for identification. First of all, the retention time, the molecular ion, the mass of molecular ion, the mass of one fragment, two fragments, and the ratio of the two fragments. So we have five levels of identification that allow us the an ambiguous identification. It's if we have all these parameters are the same, it seems that the molecules are the same, no way. And also the sequence of the the sample in the analysis batch is important, because to avoid false positive and also false negative. Now in this case, the blank, the extract, so the real sample, and then the fortified sample. So if blank is blank, we have no carryover, we have no contamination, etc. Then we have our sample, and then we have the fortified sample. So the sample in which we have added a mix of all the analytes. And so if we have the blank sample is blank and the fortified sample, we see all our analytes, we can avoid a false positive and false negative. In this case, our analysis is quite reliable. And then we have all the definitions for the all the parameters that I will not report to you. Then I just listed here for your curiosity, if you want to check later. And then I just thank you, thanks a lot for your attention and for stay here with me in this in this talk. Thanks a lot.
Are there any questions from the audience?
You can also so here is my email. So if you want to do some question now, or if you want to contact me for any kind of curiosity and information about this talk, or even other curiosities, my email is here, and I will respond usually not immediately, but in few days usually I can answer all the email.
Thank you.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. I'm available by email at any time, really.
Okay, no questions then.
Okay.
So, thank you and goodbye to all.
Thanks a lot. I hope to see you soon.